We claim that this video and series show a clear way how all 8 billion humans could and should thrive, while also solving all their challenges. We claim that the transformation of degenerated agricultural lands into carbon agroforests, especially the transformation of degenerated agriculture lands as well as degenerated forests in tropical and subtropical regions, would produce 100 times more, and would produce all products, goods, and services, when compared to what the most modern agriculture can produce on a similar amount of land. Next in this video, you will be able to see the proof of this on a near global scale with your own eyes, by means of a short video that starts playing now on your screen. First, you will see that all the vegetation, etc., of the Northern Hemisphere is unable to capture all the carbon dioxide the Northern Hemisphere emits. And consequently, in a matter of less than 6 months, the Northern Hemisphere gets engulfed by the accumulation of carbon dioxide dominantly from fossil origin. What you do not see, but what you easily can conclude, is that the Southern Hemisphere is able to capture all the carbon dioxide it emits, this plus the carbon dioxide from the Northern Hemisphere that comes even near or leaks into the Southern Hemisphere. You should come to this conclusion that this is so, because you know that carbon dioxide is a gas, and that there is no real barrier between the Northern and Southern Hemisphere. Again, nobody seems to pose the question why this is so. We will answer this question right now, because it is quite simple and it is quite direct to answer. The answer is that the Amazon forest and the Central African forest both lie in the Southern Hemisphere, and are able to capture all the emitted carbon dioxide of the Southern Hemisphere, plus the part of the Northern Hemisphere that dominantly is of fossil fuel origin, and that is transported by weather systems and obviously also directly and constantly kind of leaks into the Southern Hemisphere. That is so for the number of months of emissions you assisted, which roughly was the first 6 months of the year 2021, or more specifically from the 1st of January 2021, until 31th of June 2021. Roughly from the 1st of July on, the atmosphere in the Northern Hemisphere has heated and expanded so much that the carbon dioxide mainly overflowing from the Northern Hemisphere, and as said dominantly of fossil origin, invades the Southern Hemisphere so massively that from that point of time and of the season, also the Southern Hemisphere is overflown with carbon dioxide from the Northern Hemisphere that is detected as being of fossil fuel origin. The on your screen indirectly shown, and here described large-scale movement of air masses loaded with carbon dioxide from fossil origin, from the Northern Hemisphere to the Southern Hemisphere across the equator, is a yearly and repeating seasonal event. Most presentations of carbon dioxide that present the Northern and Southern Hemisphere carbon dioxide accumulation, in one way or another, distract from this what we mentioned and illustrated, and what obviously should be avoided. We illustrate and explain some of the distractions in other videos. Leaving aside the discussion if carbon dioxide accumulation is very bad or very good, we will focus on something else that in our opinion matters much more. What we want to illustrate on a global scale, and right before your eyes, is the amount of biomass production that is missed out mostly on land in the Northern Hemisphere, but as you can see on your screen at this point of the season also in the Southern Hemisphere. The missed out biomass production in the Northern Hemisphere alone certainly is far over 100 times more, and probably over 1,000 times more than the crop food production in the Northern Hemisphere. These calculations are made in other videos. Logic should demand that once you have produced all the food you need, you should consider producing or aim at using your biomass producing capacity to produce all the rest you need, which are, or could be, fuels, basic materials, products, goods as well as electricity. This is not at all what happens in the Northern Hemisphere. What happens instead in the Northern Hemisphere is intensive husbandry for meat and dairy in a system of high-density animal confinement, often called factory farming, that uses mechanized technology and concentrated feed to maximize production and profit. Probably quite substantial amounts of these lucrative meat and dairy products will end up being exported and sold for high prices on markets in the tropics. This intensive husbandry for meat and dairy in the Northern Hemisphere involves housing large numbers of animals in restricted spaces like barns or pens, demanding external feed in order to provide the external feed needed to feed the animals. Further, this minimizes land use for the animals' natural behaviors such as grazing, and decreases the areas under pasture, which especially in the context of this video have advantages over intensive agriculture, but especially so for the health and quality of life of the held animals. Further, this approach aims for high output, but faces significant ethical, environmental, and public health concerns. Most important in the context of this video, this will create demand for external feed, like for instance corn and soy. The tropicalization of crops. The demand for corn and soy for animal feed is a significant driver of corn and soy production in the tropics. The global expansion of industrialized livestock farming, especially in the Northern Hemisphere, particularly for poultry and pork, has created a massive market for crops like corn and soy. A vast majority of the world's soy crop, around 75% to 80%, is used to feed livestock in the Northern Hemisphere. For poultry and pigs especially, corn provides energy and soy provides the necessary protein, making these two crops the cornerstone of efficient, low-cost meat production. As global meat consumption continues to rise, the demand for these feed ingredients grows in tandem. All this caused or drove the tropicalization of crops. The tropicalization of crops certainly causes pressure on the Amazon forest and natural vegetation in general, and consequently of irreversible degeneration of soils, which we see as the major and as an irreversible problem. Northern Hemisphere drive for profit and demand for the cheapest possible food accelerates soil degeneration, spurred a feedback loop of food and other shortages and rising costs for foods and products across the world. We started out claiming that the transformation of degenerated agricultural lands into carbon agroforests, especially the transformation of degenerated agriculture lands as well as degenerated forests in tropical and subtropical regions, would produce 100 times more, and would produce all products, goods, and services, when compared to what the most modern agriculture can produce on a similar amount of land. The choice of the Northern Hemisphere to opt for intensive husbandry for meat and dairy in a system of high-density animal confinement, often called factory farming, that uses mechanized technology and concentrated feed to maximize production and profit, that is uniquely of intensive husbandry for meat and dairy, inverts of what is needed if we want to avoid the degeneration of 90% of all agricultural land by the year 2050, and further deforestation, especially in the tropics, which obviously also will further degenerate all forest land, especially tropical forest land and even more the Amazon forest and land. Without judging, we want to warn that progressing degeneration of whatever kind of land, especially together with further deforestation, will cause a never announced and never witnessed direct and indirect increase of carbon dioxide accumulation in the Earth's atmosphere. Back to the complete capture of emitted carbon dioxide in the Southern Hemisphere. Apart from the Amazon forest and the other tropical forests, also located in the Southern Hemisphere, the high-yielding Brazilian and South American agriculture, often with over 2 yields per year, are also part of the explanation. In the case of agriculture, these very high yields come with a price, and that is soil degeneration at a greater rate than the medium degeneration rate of the world. And this brings us back to our subject. The need to transform agriculture into carbon agroforest is much greater and much more rentable in the case of Brazilian and South American agricultural land, especially so in already degenerated agricultural lands. If the here proposed transformation from agriculture to carbon agroforest should occur, carbon agroforests, along with all other vegetation, would sequester all the excess carbon dioxide emitted by the world and, of course, transform it all into biomass, which, as explained, can be redirected into food, products, superior fuels and electricity, etc., as desired. 8 billion humans could thrive as never before. This proved to be realistic and probably superior, and 100 times more production of all products, goods and services that we 8 billion humans need and demand, could make all 8 billion humans thrive. That is, if the form of production proposed here were applied to sufficient land. And if we do not transform. This while if we humans do not depart for the here proposed carbon agroforest practices, our existence will be irreversible challenged really soon, simply because of the above-mentioned fact that the actual percentage of degenerated and unproductive agricultural lands will rise from the already jaw-dropping actual 30 to 40% up to 90%, leaving only 10% of all agricultural lands productive, this as soon as by the year 2050, which is said represents only 1/6 or even only 1/7 of the actual production. It is obvious that this inevitable degeneration of our actual agricultural soils, at least so when we refuse to change our practices to carbon agroforest practices, will very soon become an extreme challenge for all 8 billion modern humans, and that this fact does not get nearly the attention it should get. This lack of attention clearly shows us that we are fully able to turn our backs on and keep ourselves blind of what is of scale and really matters, and is decisive for our existence. This mentioned degeneration, especially in combination with the fact that traditional agriculture totally depends on fertilizers, that already are ending resources, and different from many or most other resources, are not even recyclable. The Club of Rome's 1972 report, The Limits to Growth, predicted that continuous exponential growth in consumption and population would exceed the Earth's carrying capacity within a century. Many could think that these predictions did not become true, and possibly abuse this wrong assumption as a kind of evidence that these kinds of predictions are wrong all along. This while in fact these predictions since 1972 never were wrong, and still are very well in line with what is really happening. The exponential growth in consumption and population turned to happen soon after, and were never reversed. Yet here we are, nothing done, and nobody even caring about what is unfolding. A population growth standstill or even reversal will not at all reverse the degenerated soils and not even stop further degeneration. The Club of Rome's 1972 report used world fertilizer consumption as one of the many data points in its world model, to illustrate how exponential growth in various sectors, including agriculture, would impact global systems. 100 times more production in reach. Claiming to achieve 100 times more production for the same area of land, even if that was 100 times more value production, is a very bold claim. But even if it initially only were 10 times more, this already would have enormous advantages and potential. The actual agricultural lands of Brazil today roughly produce 10% of all food of the world. With 10 to 100 times more production, because of the bias and here proposed carbon agroforest practices, that mainly are the transformation from agricultural lands to carbon agroforests, the actual agricultural lands of Brazil could produce from all the food of the world, up to 10 times all the food of the world, or all the food of the world, plus all products, goods, and services that we 8 billion humans need and demand, for an inferior price and enough to make 8 billion humans sustain and even thrive as never before, while sustainably providing them with healthy organic food, superior fuels that will all be renewable, and close to all other goods that also will all be renewable, as well as all forms of security, including energy security, including in a decentralized, and even to consumption centers directed manner. All produced food would be organic food, simply because traditional fertilizers and herbicides etc. will not be needed at all, and in fact are not really efficient or even redundant or even damaging when applied in carbon agroforests. In the sidelines, we inform that there is plenty of evidence that crops from such carbon agroforests, that we call carbon agroforest crops or food, and that includes all ingredients of standard diets, is the main reason that certain Amazon Amerindians provingly and by far present the best heart and brain health in the world, and further are benefited with a relative absence of degenerative diseases. That was detected amongst those that feed themselves with these carbon agroforest crops or food. Further, we claim that close to all 8 billion modern humans still are unaware that such health benefits and such healthy foods exist. Consensus and business as usual kind of fail to research and inform the general public about these long-term researched and proven health benefits, and has said that such foods even exist.